you young men have this war to win. It is small unit leadership that is going to win the ground battle, and that battle must be won before that enemy of ours is finally crushed. General Fanshaw, gentlemen, I am keenly sensible of the honor that General Fanshaw has done me, a foreigner, by asking me down here to witness the passing out review of a class from his famous military college. Yet on your soil, I do not feel particularly a foreigner or a stranger. Since 1812, there has been no question, no difference arising between our two countries that hasn't been capable of amicable settlement. Within one lifetime, your nation and mine has found ourselves partners in a great war. In this war, more than any other in history, I think that we find the forces of evil arranged against those of decency, of respect for humankind, than ever before. We are on the side of decency and democracy and liberty. Happily, we have great allies. Every morning, as we read our papers these days, we have reasons to give another cheer as the great Russian army hammers back the German and inflicts upon him still further losses. Our great air arms, both by night and by day, are punishing that enemy. They're softening him up. But much remains to be done. We can and we will win this war. But it means that every one of us, no matter where he is or what he's doing, must do his full duty. Let none of us escape this one point. Any person, whether he is at the plow in the field or at a gun with a gun at the front, that fails to do his full duty every day, every hour, must forever bear on his own conscience the certainty that he's contributed in some incalculable amount, be it little or be it great, to the agony and the anguish and the sacrifice that our two countries must endure. It behooves us then to think of what these duties are, particularly those of our own. Our governments arrange that the resources of these great allies are used in such way as to inflict the greatest punishment upon the enemy and most quickly to accomplish his defeat. The manpower, the industrial resources, the products of the mines in the field, they are distributed by authorities higher than our own, higher than ourselves. It becomes the job of the high command in the navies, in the air, in the land, to see that these resources in the battlefield are gathered together, placed into action, properly led, properly organized, and properly maintained to win those victories. Among ourselves, I think we've already shown, beyond any doubt, that we can work together as a unified team with no trouble whatsoever in the accomplishment of this purpose. But as we get down to the ground armies, there are more technical problems arising, one type of which you yourselves have been earnestly engaged in mastering, that of the mechanized warfare. You are one member of a great team, great ground team. The ground team itself, of course, is only a member of the great triumvirate of the land, sea, and air. The high command can do no more than to put you in action in the best possible way, under the best possible condition, and to make sure that you are well supplied, well cared for, everything is done for you in the way of getting you ammunition, food, clothing, and everything that you need. But upon your shoulders rests the greatest responsibility of all. It is up to you men to give your units, whether it is a tank crew, a platoon, or becomes a company, leadership every hour of the day, every day of the week. You must know every single one of your men. It is not enough that you are the best soldier in that unit, that you are the strongest, the toughest, the most durable, the best equipped technically. You must be their leader, their father, their mentor, even if you're half their age. You must understand their problems. You must keep them out of trouble. If they get in trouble, you must be the one that goes to their rescue. That cultivation of human understanding between you and your men is the one art that you must yet master, and you must master it quickly. Then you will be doing your duty, and you will be worthy of the traditions of this great school and of your great country. To each one of you, I wish Godspeed and good luck. If I could have my wish as I stand here today, feeling honored as I do on the tribute paid me, I would say this: if I could only meet you all somewhere east of the Rhine and renew the acquaintanceship of this pleasant morning. Good luck.
Now we want those names.